to first of all request the Honorable Justice to please grace the dais. She is going to take this panel on the importance of IBC. Ladies and gentlemen, big round of applause to Honorable Justice Bharati Dangre. On the panel, we have Honorable Justice V. Nala Senapathy, who is member technical for NCLT. May I request, as Justice steps up, we'd also like to request Senior Advocate Mr. Janakalyan Das to please join up. On the panel, Director ONGC, former Chairman IBA, and also on the board for Standard Chartered Bank, Mr. O.P. Bhatt. From NCLT, Ravi Kumar Dorai Swami, who is a member of NCLT also. Senior Advocate Soli Cooper. And from SEBI, Sandeep Parekh. Ladies and yet another very wonderful panel. This is the second technical panel. Are we missing any? Mr. Sandeep Parekh? SEBI? Okay, probably. All right. We shall start with the panel, and I'd like to hand over the mic to the Honorable Justice Bharati Dangre.
A very good afternoon to all of you. And I'm quite conscious that after a sumptuous lunch, you must be feeling quite heavy. Of course, not with the food only, but the brainstorming sessions, the introductory remarks, the keynote address, and the introduction to the topic by the most erudite speakers. I remember that some 15 days back, there was a matter before us, and a person came, he was appearing in person, and this petitioner came and he made a very strange prayer before us. The relief was that I am intending to start a business and I'm looking out for business opportunities abroad. But there's a letter which is issued, received by me from most of the countries, and he had given 2-3 business houses, one was from UK, one was from America, some 2-3 countries, Australia. And an apprehension was expressed in this letter that please explain the legal scenario in your country, because we are not very sure. Certain enactments, and they had categorically cited certain enactments. And the foreign investor was rather very apprehensive whether we should invest in India, because the consequences are disastrous. I was amazed, and initially the thought that came to my mind that this petition has to be thrown away immediately. Who is he? But then, today, when we are attending this seminar or this conclave, I realize the importance that unless and until to have the ease of doing business in this country, unless and until the laws are very clear, we are not very sure whether the forest investment and what we are calling an economic of growth of this country is going to happen. I must first of all congratulate Legal India and the Supreme Court Bar Association for taking up this bold initiative of rather going for a topic which is still novice, and it is in a nascent stage. Just 3 years have passed when we are introduced to this code. And in the first introductory session, and I must also congratulate for choosing the speakers very carefully. We had, of course, none other than the Honorable Judge of the Supreme Court, then an erudite speaker and a person who is very conversant with the commercial terminology, Justice Sri Krishna. You had an opportunity of having Justice Bhushan Gawai as the chairing the first session. And right from those persons who had rather conceived this idea, we had amongst us Mr. Vishwanathan, who has contributed in drafting the said code. And rather we can say that he was part of this movement right from this idea was conceived. Then we have the implementers or the adjudicators in form of the members of NCLT which are before us. And we also had Dr. Mukulika, the member of the regulatory board, from whom we had an insight as to how the board is exercising its regulatory function. So undisputedly, what was planned was that right from the evolution of the concept, how it progresses, and then we are at a stage that after 3 years, the data was set up before you, pointing out how many cases have come, how many cases have been settled. And no doubt, rather, all of us by this time must have understood that it is a happy scene. It is something which is yielding results. But still, we could see a small voice coming from where that there are some creases which are still required to be ironed out. And this is probably the purpose of this conclave, to see that how efficiently, we can iron out these creases with the assistance of several stakeholders who are present in the conference. I am glad to know that we have amongst us the students of the National Law University, who are the future lawyers, the future judges of tomorrow. And we know that if at this stage they are the idea and the concept is imbibed in their minds, it would be better that they give results and they participate in this moment, which has got a long way to go. And when we are talking of 2025, 2030, when the scenario, when we expect the country to be on the to be on the apex side of the economic growth, then rather these are also the stakeholders, and we consider them as stakeholders. The second session, technical session, which we are going to discuss is the impact of this code on the business houses and real estate sector. We are all aware that the real estate business in this country is on the rise since last two decades. A common man, a downtrodden person, has only one dream in his life, to have his dream home. And he probably focuses on gathering all his assets, gathering all his wealth to spend into that one home. But we are all aware that after 2014, there is slightly a boom in the market, and especially in the cities like Delhi, Calcutta, Pune, all those metro cities. Of course, as far as Bombay city is concerned, I think that the real estate is still embarking up and it has not gone down. Now, that was a single worry of a common man. The question was this: how to tackle with this situation? You have the new enactment in form of RERA, which is still, again, at a drooping stage. It's not, concepts are not very clear. It's a sort of confusion. Therefore, it was the amendment which has been introduced in June 2018 to the code itself, and bringing the home buyer within the definition of creditor, that has made a difference. Now, therefore, in this session, we will deliberate upon the effect of this code on the business houses, what impact it is going to create, and also the real estate sector. And the speakers who are going to speak and share the second session are also knowledgeable, worth giving their inputs and outputs in regards to the various difficulties that are going to be faced, various provisions in this sector, and they include the member of the ex-chairman of the IBA, Mr. O.P. Bhatt. Then we have on the panel the member of the two members of NCLT, Dr. Ravi Kumar Doraiswamy and Alan Sarpat Patti, and two senior advocates who will be deliberating on the consequences when we are talking of RERA and combining it with the present code. We will deliberate on this issue. I take this opportunity to firstly invite Mr. O.P. Bhatt to deliver his address.
Thank you, madam. So, Honorable Justice Dangre, other eminent lordships, members of the bar, members here at the panel, distinguished audience, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor for me to be here at this gathering, which is actually of very, very eminent legal experts. And I have to make a caveat: I'm not a lawyer, I'm not a chartered accountant, and I used to work for a bank, but I'm no longer a banker either. So how much I'll be able to contribute to this August conference remains to be seen. Since morning, I've been sitting here and listening to various distinguished speakers talk on this subject. So much has actually already been said, and some of it has actually been said more than once. And I think while introducing this panel and this topic, Justice Dangre, she gave such an excellent overview of the subject that it will be very difficult to add anything substantial to what she has said. So let me give you a sort of a macro view. Why we are here discussing this IBC and why is it so important? You know, ultimately, everything boils down to the economy, right? Why do we work? Why do we work hard? Why do we crimp? It's all about the economy. India today is the largest and the fastest growing economy in the world. And yet, we are not able to make the aspirations for most of our people, especially the youth. And one of the reasons for this is that the NPAs in the system are stalling the system, are breaking the system, bringing it down, not allowing it to grow to the potential that the economy has. It is a given that when the kind of change that is taking place in the global and local economy because of technology, because of new delivery systems, because of new business models, because of new products and new services, there will be a huge change and ferment both in the economy and in the businesses, and many businesses, both in terms of percentages and numbers, will find it difficult to cope. Some of them will even fail. And fail they have been doing for quite some time. The longer these failed businesses and their assets, which is not only a property, plant, and equipment, but it is also the human assets, it's the promoters, it's the managers, it's the workers, the longer these are kept idle, the slower our economy will be, the longer it will take to recover. And which is why this IBC, the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, the whole idea of this code is to make creative destruction of the economy, just like Shiva does, more smoother, more streamlined, more faster, and more relevant to our economic needs. Before this code came, let me go back to how I, as a former banker, see the system works. To my mind, there is an unwritten partnership between the establishment, which is the government and the regulators, between the financing community, which is bankers and other financial agencies, and between the businesses. The unwritten partnership is to create wealth, prosperity, and employment for the country. For this, they have been working within the framework which has been there for the last maybe 7 decades, which has been changed, modified, altered, depending upon what is the trigger, what is the need, what is the relevance, what can be done to make the system operate better. So the establishment was providing the ecosystem, the legal system, law and order, regulation. The financiers were providing the capital, and the businesses were taking the risks. They were providing entrepreneurship. They were actually providing their lifeblood to this system. And together, I think a lot happened. Not only India today is the largest growing, fastest growing largest economy in the world, but it is also, I think, number 5th in terms of economic hierarchy among nations of the world. Out of 192 nations, we are ranked as number 5. We are self-sufficient in food and agriculture and many things. So, because of this system, a lot has happened. We've got good infrastructure, we've got electricity all over. There is a lot that has happened because of this combined partnership of businesses, financial systems, and the government establishment all put together. But as I said, when things are changing and things are changing fast, and businesses are failing fast, if you do not allow them to fail fast, fail safe, and fail so that you can learn to rise again, then we will be doing injustice to our economies. And which is where this code comes in. The experience that I have about this, so earlier also there used to be NPA resolution, and there were a lot of structures that were experimented with by the Reserve Bank of India. There was a joint lenders forum, there was the BAFR, there was the 4S, there was 5/25 restructuring. There were all kinds of things that were attempted. But because the legal structure underpinning these attempts was not sound, it could take ages, decades for any resolution to come. And whenever such a thing happens, it is the bad boys in the system who take advantage of it. So things were not moving, a lot of mistrust built up, and a lot of wrong advantage was taken of the system. The IBC, it unifies many such laws and codes, I think maybe 12, 13, or 15 of them into one, and so that everything is available at one place. The small experience that we have so far, it's been there for about 2.5 years, I think it's really good. Resolution has become faster, resolution has become better. Almost half the cases have been resolved, and almost 48% recovery has been made. And in the case of State Bank of India, for which I have some information, almost 58% has been recovered. Now, this would not have been possible under the earlier regime. So one of the things that has happened is that things are moving fast, things are moving in the right direction. The other thing which has happened, which is not coming to fore so much, is that behind the IBC and even before a case can be taken to IBC, now borrowers and bankers both together have become alert to the possibility that if this account were to become an NPA, if this promoter were to be declared as a willful defaulter, and if this were to go to the proceedings of the IBC, almost everything is taken out of from everybody's hands. So whether it is the promoter, you know, there is a system, the NCLT, which will take a decision. So therefore, now there is anecdotal evidence that increasingly a large number of such accounts are in a proactive manner trying to get themselves regularized before this event happens. And surprisingly, there are a large number of private equity firms or boutique firms which are willing to lend money to this activity. Now, this is a huge positive. Proactively, preemptively, accounts going bad being prevented within the system so that the system can remain, you know, ever young, ever new, and contribute to the economy of the country. So this is a huge positive effect of the IBC. With all that said and done, IBC is still work in progress. It is still evolving. So the challenges that are being thrown to the IBC by promoters and prospective investors alike are ironing out the wrinkles in the code, are bringing up issues which were not foreseen. And therefore, my belief is that as time goes on, so there are small issues. For example, what do you do with a person who is a personal guarantor? Or what do you do with a person who is an operational creditor? Or what do you do cross-border? There are a lot of such issues. Or even the committee of creditors, is it empowered enough? Does it work fast enough? Is it working in the right direction? The people who go and sit in the COC, are they of enough seniority? Do they have to go back and take permission from their seniors or go to the board? Can this time process be compressed in some way? So in almost every aspect of the working of this IBC, within the NCLT, within the banks, within the COC, there are a lot of wrinkles even now. But with all that, what is good to see is, from the literature, from anecdotal evidence, from people who talk to you about this, is that everybody is trying to make the system just a little better. Everybody feels that this is the best system that we have had so far in this country, so much so that even the World Bank and the IMF have been praising this system. And if India has risen in the global ranking of the East to do business, this particular intervention has played no smaller role in this. So I think this is one of the best things that has happened to the, not only the banking system, but the economy, to the businesses. And going forward, I think this is going to contribute even better to us and to our economy. So I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bhatt. This was the voice of a business house, and from the words that are spoken by Mr. Bhatt, we could gather as to what a business house expects from this squad. Now I request Justice Nala Senapati, the member of the NCLT, to express his views.
Respected dignitaries, on the dais and off the dais, good afternoon. At the outset, I want to say one thing, that we need not look all the corporate debtors or the industrialists with a jaundiced eye. See, I have started my career as an accountant in a small company in Coimbatore. I know how it is difficult to incorporate a company in India in those days, 1980s. Right from getting one OYT telephone, that time we had to pay 15,000 rupees. Then that is giving this memorandum of association and articles of association with the registrar of companies and getting it vetted and getting started a company, taking a place for rent. So unless otherwise the rent or your own building is there, rented building or your own building is there, the sales tax authorities will not give you the sales tax CST, and GST registration number. See, that is what the problem in incorporating a company in India. Then getting bank loans. I know how many times I went to bankers with a profit and loss account and this balance sheet. He will say, change this, change that. what is the mortgage you are going to give, get the legal opinion. See, the industrialists are taking such kind of risk. Can anybody take such kind of risk in bringing a company? Then you have to see the product. You have to produce. Then labor problem. Then marketing. Then only you will be in a position to see the color of the coin. See, we are taking holidays, Saturdays and Sundays. But the industrialist has to pay interest for Saturdays and Sundays also. See, these are the practical difficulties. Then, subsequently, I was the official assignee of Madras High Court. Having an opportunity to deal with these individuals' insolvencies. See, in the Presidency Towns Insolvency Act 1909, if a person files and comes to the box and says, I am unable to pay the debt, yes, he is declared as an insolvent. This act is there in three cities only, metropolitan cities. That is Calcutta, Bombay and Chennai. Only in these three cities, under the Presidency Towns Insolvency Act, if somebody comes and says, yes, I want to be declared as an insolvent, I am unable to pay the debts, that is an act of insolvency and you'll be declared as an insolvent. But that is not the case with the Provincial Insolvency Act. See, we have to give notice to all the creditors. It is a long-drawn process. See, like our Section 10 petition, if somebody comes and says, I am unable to pay the debts, we have to declare him as an insolvent. See, I can say that 80 to 90% of the individual insolvencies really are genuine, except certain finance companies and the speculative share brokers and all those things. So we cannot paint with the same brush all the industrialists that, see, they are all fraud, this thing, that thing. So only when we experience all those things, we will be in a position to know. Then further, insolvency is a stigma attached to the personality. Nobody wants to come for an insolvency voluntarily unless otherwise the situation warrants. So what I want to say is, in most of the cases, genuine business failures are there. See, take for example, power sector, then this telecom sector. Telecom sector, now the outstanding is 4 lakh crores. I don't know the figure in power sector. See, there are change in the business environment. Often the policies are changed. So these kind of things will naturally come. See, fortunately, after right from 2002 to 2016, there was legal battles. See, all these Presidency Towns Insolvency Act, Provincial Act, Companies Act, Sick Industries Act, then the RDDB Act, SARFAESI, almost all these acts, there was, to some extent, there was failure. So this IBC came into force after a long battle right from 2000. 2000, in fact, in the year 2000, Justice Jayasimha Babu of Madras High Court, this constitutional validity has been upheld. Then MBA came, Madras Bar Association went up to Supreme Court, and finally we got this. See, this is the one of the celebrated law which has shown the success in a very short span of time. Within 2.5 years, we could see the color of the coin, nearly 1 lakh crore to the financial sector, and then the settlement by some more than around 2 lakh crores. Daily 5 to 7 cases are settling in our court itself. The people are coming for settlement. They are settling it. Some cases, some time has to be given. That is what our experience here also. See, I would like to address certain issues in the administration of insolvency bankruptcy code in general. See, the first issue is, what we are talking is delay which is claimed to be hurting the banks. See, as far as NCLTs are concerned, despite a lorry load of work, we are making our best efforts. The committee of creditors shall be more responsive, shall take quick decisions in approving the resolution plan presented before the COC. It is not only that they have to comply with the provisions of the code, but also they should take into consideration the rulings of the Honorable NCLAT and Honorable Supreme Court in this regard, so that there won't be any hiccups in the problems in the approval of resolution plan. The Honorable NCLAT is insisting that Among the class of creditors, the treatment shall be equal. Then in majority of the resolution plans approved by COC, the operational creditors are not given the proper fair treatment. Hence, they are coming before NCLTs with grievances, and naturally, it takes some time to decide those issues. IBC is a new law that is still evolving, and hence settling various points of law and removing ambiguities in the code is leading to long-drawn litigations. The Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India laid down model timelines for various stages in the resolution process. If the resolution professional and COC try to adhere to the timelines prescribed by IBBI, it will speed up the process. The next issue is haircuts are very high. Once a corporate person is put into CIRP process, there is no point in bothering much about the haircuts. When the business environment is good, if there are more number of bidders, haircuts will be less. Otherwise, high percentage of haircuts are inevitable. At this point of time, there is no point in blaming the lenders that they have not done this, not done that, blah, blah, and all those things. This kind of post-mortem at a belated stage may not end up anywhere. The next is the wisdom of COC. Once a resolution plan is approved by COC with the required majority voting of 66%, can the adjudicating authority question it? Under Section 31 of the Code, the adjudicating authority has in many cases reviewed the resolution plan to see whether it does or does not conform to the requirements of the code. In some of the cases, it was ruled that commercial wisdom of the COC is paramount and the same cannot be challenged. The Honorable Apex Court in the case of Sasidharan versus Indian Overseas Bank laid down the law that commercial wisdom of COC cannot be challenged. The NCLT is not an equity court. It is non-justiciable. Then this next thing is no representation to the operational creditors in COC. The Honorable Supreme Court in Swiss Rubens versus Union of India has held that upheld the constitutional validity of IBC. More importantly, the judgment justified the differential treatment given to the operational creditors while comparing the beneficial treatment to the financial creditors. The next is Section 29A, ineligibility of the bidders. This section intends to keep out errant and willful defaulters from buying back the company. In many cases, the existing promoters may be best suited to run the company, provided their intentions are good and insolvency status of the business is due to external constraints. Genuine business failure may be the cause for the present state of affairs. Hence, the easing up of provision in deserving cases may help the revival of the company. Then next is the Section 12A, withdrawal of the petition. This section allows the withdrawal of the petition by the applicant with the approval of 90% of the voting of the COC. The Honorable Supreme Court went ahead and laid down the law stating that the NCLT can allow withdrawal of an application by the petitioner by exercising the inherent powers under Section 11 of the NCLT rules. See, previously, there is a Bombay High Court judgment of 1960s. I can't remember the case. In the case of individual insolvencies, when a person is adjudicated as an insolvent, if you go for withdrawal of this petition, normally they will say, the honorable judges will say, see, already he has settled the matter, what is the problem in withdrawing? Normally, as an official assignee, we say that other creditors are there, so it is an order in rem, this would not be allowed. But usually, they will allow it, even we object this, they will pass orders, yes, they will go out of insolvency, they will with allow for the withdrawal of the petition. The Honorable Bombay High Court in the year 1960s, I don't know the judgment, I think the Justice Turpurkar or some name, it was clearly stated that the Honorable Judge directed, see, the I am advising the brother judges who is looking after this insolvency, at the time of allowing the withdrawal of this petition, they should ask the official assignee to give notice to all the creditors. So that was the stringency in the law, I mean the difficult thing. You see, you have to give credit to 100%, 100 creditors will be there. You have to give notice to all the creditors. See, now in the section 12A, that kind of problem is not there. Immediately they can come and file the withdrawal petition, then they will go out of the insolvency process. With this, I would like to conclude. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Nala Senapati. We had the views of the member of the NCLT, and now before we have another member, Mr. Ravi Kumar Doraiswamy, who is also a member of NCLT. But to break the sequence, I would rather request the senior advocate, Sri Das, to express his views on the...
Honorable Justice Ramana, Judge of the Supreme Court, within brackets NP, which generally is used against us, it means non-present, in absentia. Honorable Mr. Justice, former Judge of the Supreme Court, Justice Sri Krishna, within bracket NP, it's a lighter vein, please don't take it, don't carry it seriously. Honorable Justice Gawai, luckily present. Madam Justice Bharti, all other respected distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, my dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, in a way I represent the Supreme Court Bar Association, and I should be frank enough to first clarify as to why we are here. Innovative Industries versus ICICI Bank was the first detailed, meaningful judgment by the Supreme Court on the code. ISP, Insolvency and Banking Code, was first tested meaningfully by the Supreme Court, Justice Nariman's judgment. That was the first detailed judgment delineating, elaborating the objects and reasons of the Insolvency and Banking Code. And the second most important recent judgment passed by the Supreme Court is in the Swiss Ribbons case, which has upheld the constitutional validity and in its entirety of the Act. In view of these two recent judgments, Honorable Justice Ramana impressed upon the Supreme Court Bar Association members, and including we who are in the Executive Committee, that here is the time that the Supreme Court Bar Association, being the leader in the sense that Article 141 of the Constitution, whatever law is declared, is binding upon all other courts, you should go participate meaningfully in whatever conferences take place around the country. You yourself initiate a conference, and thereafter come and educate the other junior members of the bar. That is precisely the reason as to why we are here, and therefore that is the bounden duty and the duty cast upon us. In view of that, in the light of that, we are here in collaboration with legal leadership and in this conclave. Now, so much so regarding the background, little more on the further background of this matter. It is maybe my personal view, it is not reflected in the legislative history. After the colonial period, if you read James Bryce, as a student of political science or politics, if you read the book Modern Democracies by James Bryce, followed by K.C. Ware, Federal Government, you come across two chapters: the decline of modern legislation, the decline of modern legislatures in third world countries. And they say the decline of modern legislature is on account of the fact that in third world countries, no effective and meaningful legislation can be passed. This myth has been shattered by the passing of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. It's my personal submission, and I think I'm not wrong in this. Because a third world country for the first time has shown to the world that lawmaking is not only legal construction, but legal consolidation through construction and amalgamation. The code constructs by amalgamating the earlier various other inconsistent provisions which were there, which were handling the problem in a very peaceful manner. So in order to bring about a holistic, wholesale engineering, legal engineering, or social and economic development through the process of law, which is essentially the essence of law to bring about social distributive justice from each according to his ability to each according to his need, by bringing about a restructuring of the socio-economic system. That is the intendment of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. The philosophy underlining the code also is what Deng Xiaoping of China had said, and that is how China has amassed so much. Save the patient and cure the illness and save the patient. So when an industry is pushed to a brink to a point where it is going to die and it is terminally sick, you try and do something so that the sickness is cured and the industry is saved. Now, these two being the prompting or the motivating factors beyond legislation, in my considered opinion, I may be wrong, subject to correction, but these are the motivating considerations. Now, Westerners always used to poo-poo or look down upon the Indian legislators as if, well, we are not competent enough to pass class legislations, I mean, quality legislations. As a student in the year 2006, I was shocked when we had the Enron boom. The American corporate world was shocked with the Enron scam. That scam was a huge scam of banking fraud and insolvency fraud. And D.W. Brogan, a senator in USA, the American Senate, he said, the era of laissez-faire, or the state sitting over the fence, doing nothing, doing only discharging only police functions, is gone. Now we are in a welfare state. The state has to be either a driver or a brake. It cannot be a spare wheel. Regulatory measures ought to be passed. Stringent regulatory measures ought to be passed. This was the fallout of the famous Enron scam of USA in the year 2006, a decade before insolvency and banking laws was enacted in 2016. And what came out, the net result is this. I read, the Enron scandal did, however, produce some reforms. After Enron, most business schools now include ethics courses. Congress enacted law that adopted new standards for audit reports, requiring disclosure of companies' relationships with entities of the sort created at Enron, and mandated that executives sign the financial reports. And then a host of legislation was passed in USA to completely regulate the entire insolvency and bankruptcy scenario. Now, as far as I am concerned here, on account of time constraints, I may limit, almost all speakers have said, on the very structure of the objection regions of the insolvency code. Before I dwell upon my limited exercise, I would certainly, since I'm in a position, congratulate the NCLT Mumbai for two specific reasons. One is giving a very meaningful interpretation to Section 328, and secondly, on Chapter 7 of the Act, dealing with offences and penalties, in which the bench has thrown out a Section 10 petition at its very threshold and has imposed a cost of 50 lakh rupees and has directed prosecution for willful suppression of earlier binding of order by the applicant. These sort of orders really send a signal all over the across the country, and these are things which should also be looked into, because at the end of the day, the fraud, the banking frauds committed under the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, the fraudsters are not only white-collared, they are gold-collared, or I should say diamond-collared criminals. And I say this with utmost responsibility because it is all documented. I'll read it out from a particular piece where it is said so. It has been said that resolution professionals handling various corporate insolvency resolution programs under the insolvency and bankruptcy framework have referred to a large number of fraudulent transactions. These transactions reported in over 110 companies under resolutions are worth over rupees 40,000 crores even on a conservative estimate. The records reveal that frauds, which include siphoning of funds, transactions with related parties, and fictitious persons, are widespread in cases that have been referred to the NCLT across the country. Now, I have a limited mandate in as much as my endeavor is only to focus upon Chapter 7 of the Act, of the Code, that is, how to make the provisions of penalty and punishment more stringent. Because unless there is a deterrence, the goal cannot be achieved. But shockingly, if you compare 2016 code with the 2017 GST, in 2017 GST you have much more stringent provisions as compared to the code. The code is absolutely divested of many such stringent provisions. For instance, the code, unlike the GST, does not specify that if there's an offense involving an amount beyond a particular limit, that offense has to be cognizable and non-billable. Unlike the GST, the code does not have a provision with a deeming fiction that once prima facie material is there, it shall be deemed that the accused is guilty, and the burden will shift and it is for him to prove that he is not guilty, which is there in most economic legislations like FEMA, like PMLA. Also, it is there in the GST. Now, therefore, make certain offenses under the code cognizable. Give the central government to delegate powers to the board to arrest and take remand of the accused. It is there in GST. Why can't it be done also in this court? This is also a piece of economic legislation. There are a large number of areas which I have analyzed. Now, what happens under the code, criminal prosecution under the code is that, as all of us know, in a criminal prosecution, it is the process which is the punishment. It's the punishment both the debtor and the creditor. Let me make it clear. Now, the code believes in, it's a special legislation, therefore the trial has to take place in a special court. Unfortunately, there are not special courts notified under the code as of today. There are very few special courts. Although the jurisdiction by a deeming fiction has been given of that of a Sessions Court, unlike the Companies Act, where the original court was a magisterial court, the court to try an offense under the Insolvency Code is supposed to be a Sessions Court. Therefore, more serious offense, therefore, a higher forum. So therefore, you lose one forum, from there you go up to the High Court and then to the Supreme Court. But why I say the process of the punishment is that the statute says you have to act as per the provisions of the CRPC. Students will know better that under CRPC, if any offense is punishable with 2 years or more, the procedure to be adopted is that of a warrant trial case instituted otherwise than on a police report, because the offense is not cognizable. The offense can be taken cognizance of only upon the filing of a complaint of a duly authorized officer under the present code. So once you take resort to the warrant trial procedure, then there is a pre-charge evidence and a post-charge evidence. And as you all know, delay will defeat the very purpose of the code. So therefore, the various sections appearing in the code, for instance, section 70, let us go to 65. 65 says, 65 is also a penal provision which has been taken resorted to. 65 starts fraudulent or malicious institutional proceedings. 66 talks about fraudulent trading or wrongful trading. 68 talks about punishment for concealment of property. Now, there are a host of other provisions also in the code which provides, for instance, section 65, 66, chapter 7, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, and 77. That is the first part of your code which deals with the companies, and regarding partnerships and persons, it is section 184, 186, 187 for individuals and partnership firms. So now, these offenses, in all these some of these offenses are punishable with more than 3 years, up to 5 years. And therefore, per force, you have to adopt the warrant trial procedure. Once you adopt the warrant trial procedure, it will take years. So therefore, my suggestion and my recommendation that a law commission should seriously deliberate, as it is there in other countries like Australia, Singapore, Hong Kong, that you adopt a summary procedure for such offences. Unless you adopt a summary procedure, which is there in GST, GST provides for a summary procedure for offences which are punishable even beyond 2 years. So unless you adopt a summary procedure of trial, it will be a meaningless exercise. So therefore, you have to have a summary procedure. You have to have a dimming fiction by taking recourse to section 106 of the Evidence Act, where the burden shifts because the facts are exclusive to the knowledge of the accused. An insolvency professional cannot go on scouting around for documents. The documents are within the exclusive knowledge of the accused. So therefore, it is his bounden duty to place it first. So therefore, the burdens will shift in terms of section 106 of the Evidence Act. It is for the accused to prove. Once there is a prima facie material, the burdens will shift. It is there in Negotiable Instrument Act. It is there in GST Act. It is there in BMLA. Why not in this economic legislation, which is much more important, which is more holistic, which really intends to bring about social justice through a process of holistic social engineering. So these are some of the areas, because my mandate is a brief mandate confined only to the offenses and penalties aspect, how to make it, give it more teeth, make it more meaningful. And therefore, it is my first suggestion that the Law Commission should seriously contemplate upon this aspect and thereafter, take steps so that amendments are passed in these directions. So I'll not take more of your time. Thank you very much once again for giving me this opportunity to share with you.
Thank you, Mr. Das. May I now request Mr. Ravi Kumar Doraiswamy, the member of the NCLT, to throw some light on the topic.
Good afternoon to all, especially to the honorable members and the justice on the dais and off the dais. The topic is very, very important topic, but it was slated on the post-lunch session. But still the people are active and the audience are very active. The topic is impact of insolvency and bankruptcy code on business houses and real estate sector. I start with a positive note. This has brought in a lot of positive impact that was suggested by Mr. O.P. Bhatt, also the previous speaker, and who was the ex-banker, and he was the chairman of the SBI also. He's a very learned banker, had long-standing innings in the SBI. Now, as far as this banking industry is concerned and the IBC is concerned, and as far as any business house is concerned, there are three important regulators. Basically, like in case of the IPOs, you have the SEBI, Securities and Exchange Board of India, and in case of for the banking funds, you have the regulator, the Reserve Bank of India, and in case of the IBC, you have that IBBI, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. So all these three I's contribute to the IBC and for the industrial development by of the various guidelines and various regulations. Again, to substantiate this, the impact, our India has been ranked as 77th place as per the World Bank's report of ease of doing business as per the latest ranking, which was more than 138 in few years back. And we are the top-ranked country in the South Asia. So this all gives credit and the impact of the IBC proceedings. So that itself speaks volume for the impact of the IBC on the business houses. As we know, everyone, like every business will have its own life cycle. There could be the startup, there could be the growth, there could be the decline. Like we can say that, like in case of the resolution or the liquidation. So liquidation is the end, we can say that. Now, for any business, what we are saying is that it's there that employment generation is also an important along with the GDP growth and contributing to the national importance. When we talk about the growth, there is some segment called as the SME or the MSME, which many of the people, they do not concentrate on this particular segment. When we say about like a SME segment, in case of the IBC, we talk about the operational creditors. They form part of the MSME or the SME segment. I'll just put some figures with respect to the SME sector. They contribute a lot for the employment generation. There are around 42.5 million number of SMEs. That's both registered and unregistered. And they contribute to 40% of the Indian workforce. Maybe like many people, we are not aware of that. We all only think of the major companies, like the listed companies, only like we think of that. And this is the only sector which contributes next to the agricultural sector. And they contribute significantly to the GDP and to the manufacturing sector. Their output is also approximately 45% of the total manufacturing output. And they contribute significantly to the SME sector for the exports also. Why I'm giving all these figures is that to see that like most of the companies, when they come here, like operational creditors, they file a number of cases. So when we say the operational creditors, they are the suppliers. For any industries, they are the suppliers, they are the service providers, they are the employees. For any company, even if it's a builder, or even if it's a mobile phone manufacturer, or even if it is a car manufacturer, you may have the car. To build the car, like you have a lot of suppliers. To sell the car also, you need media people for the advertising. You need the authorized dealers, and you need that people to transport. So they all form part of the important segment of the operational creditors. So we have been talking about the financial creditors more. And the financial creditors, they are the members of the COC. There is a concern that like even that operational creditors also should get a seat in the COC to raise their voice. Now, like in case of the listed companies, you may be aware that all the listed companies will have one small shareholders on the board to raise their voice. Maybe in case of this in the committee of creditors, even a seat can be given for the committee of a seat can be given even to the operational creditors to raise their voice. That's one of the areas like which is being discussed and which is being widely reported. So this is as far as the operational creditors are concerned. And operational creditors, they contribute a lot to the backward and the forward integrations. So this particular segment, like which cannot be eliminated or which should not be given a lighter treatment. So because like as I said, like they've been contributing significantly to the employment and the growth. And the another point is that like now when we are saying about the industry, now the RP and the IRP, they also form part of they're forming a new industry itself. A lot of avenues are available to the, all the professionals and even the young professionals. And IBBA is thinking of a particular course module for the RP professionals. But like when we say about the RP professionals, like they should be the independent person and they have the highest responsibility in the whole ecosystem of the IBC proceedings. So what our suggestion is that like when you act as an IRP, you should be very, very impartial and you are the officer of the court and you should uphold the all the dignities and as well as to uphold all the rules and regulations framed by the IBC and as well as the IBBA regulations. So in this context, the few suggestions for the IRP is that don't think that this IRP, if you're getting one assignment, that is not the end of it. So you have when you prove yourself, you'll keep getting more assignments. So therefore, the fees what you are charging and therefore like whatever you are doing, that should be acceptable to the market and it should be adequate to the market because this also enough for the concerns being raised at various forums. So this is regarding the new industry which is coming up. And the few suggestions is that, like when we say about the liquidation value and the fair market value, there's some concept over the fair market value which is not being considered at the time of the biddings. So when we say, for example, the liquidation value is 250 crores, the fair market value could be 300 crores, but even that the companies are being taken 275 crores. So this one particular issue, like which like that's again needs some kind of an what do you call the thought process required, or some kind of a debate is required, whether the bankers can accept the any value, the bidding process value, which is less than the fair market value. So because the fair market value, the concept itself is that it is an agreement between the buyer, willing seller and the willing buyer. So now my one point is that like whether the banks can take this kind of things forward, because that will have again the impact even for the operational creditors as well as also. And another point is that when we say about the liquidation value in the fair value, so why can't we say that the liquidation value, what has been arrived at as a base value, and why don't you think of like going for the open auctions? So that will be the bid price, that will be the base price. So sometimes like this kind of the open auctions that may get more value, because if the two or three peers competitors are there, if they wanted the same particular industry, because they have the expertise, like they may pitch for more. So that will again contribute to the maximization of the value of the assets. Like this, sometimes like we should also think of the innovative ideas rather than and we should also think of the out of box thinking also, like which will help us in getting maximization of the value of the assets and as well as in a time bound manner. And another point is that like in the case of the IBC proceedings, we are also seeing that like because the companies are facing the problem and the audit committee, the role of the audit committee and the role of the auditors and the forensic audit and the role of the values that becomes and that plays very significant role. So what we are also suggesting is that all the companies, whether it's listed or unlisted companies, you please ensure that your audit committee, they're accessing their due diligence very well to ensure that like, the companies are not again being referred to the IBC proceedings. And the forensic audit, like wherein like the preferential treatment, preferential transactions and the related party transactions, that can be avoided like when the company in the next few years, like maybe like all this kind of the problems under the preferential transactions may not be there. And this has contributed a significant change and the paradigm shift between the relationship of the lenders and the borrowers. The cultural shift has taken place. So as the other speaker, they were also saying that it's the earlier it was the borrower's domain. Now it is the creditors, they are in controls. So they are in the lenders, basically they are in controls. And another suggestion is that, as Mr. Gopi Bhatt was saying, that like So bankers, they should also improve themselves. Yes. So that's what is like our experience also. So when you go for the COC meetings, when you examine the any resolution professionals, you should also think that you are part of the system and you are part of the government and you are part of the stakeholders. Maybe like you can take a high level of the hackett, but whether that's going to benefit the bank, ultimately it is again will have an impact on the deposit, that's the even the small shareholders and even the small depositors, the small investors. So keeping all those things in mind, like when we say that, just try to see that whether any maximization of the value of the assets is still possible, have a good negotiation with the prospective resolution applicants. So this all will ensure that, like again, that IBC proceedings and the IBC code will further strengthen, and that will again contribute significantly to the economy of a country. So with these few words, I thought I'll close. And all these bankers also should become, it's like a 2020 match. We cannot take like such a long period, like 4 years or 5 years for the resolutions. With this, I'll thank everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Doraiswamy. Today we are fortunate to have amongst us the learned senior advocate, Sri Parekh, and I'm being informed that he is a surprise package because initially Mr. Sandeep Parekh was to speak and share, be a panel member. But I must say that apart from you, I am also fortunate to hear Mr. Parekh, the learned senior advocate. Please, sir.
Justice J. Bharti, my colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I am very nervous. So far, I was under an illusion that I am the best organizer of any of such events. But I now find Rashri and Pradeep are much more competent than me in organizing this seminar. My son was supposed to speak. There is pious obligation of son towards father, but this is the first case where the father has to follow the pious obligation of the son. Now, since the time is short and 2:30 is the valedictory, I won't take too much of time. But when I was a schoolboy, people were wondering as they want to marry the daughter, which is the best bridegroom you get. And it was believed that any family which has undergone this bankruptcy or etc., they are the richest people, and you should marry your daughter to that house where there was people were bankrupt, you know, because bankrupt means they raise a lot of money from whole world and they become bankrupt in law, but reality is that they will have lots of money. But it was also true, not only factually, but it was also true because bankrupts, nothing was happening to bankrupts at all. They, apart from calling them bankrupt, they lived a wonderful life. They had enough good houses. Everything was going on. And there the problem was enforcement problems. How do you prove that he's bankrupt? After you prove, how do you prove it is his property? It will be property of the HUF, it will be property of cousins, second cousin, 10th cousin, etc., etc. You will not be able to catch all. And the delay. Of course, in the delay, we are all responsible. There are delays by legislature in making delays as a part of. Then the judiciary adds to it by giving natural justice and things like that. And the lawyers, by judiciary, I mean both the bar and bench. And therefore, nobody was used to be caught. Now, the recent amendments and the new provisions are intended to see that that delay should be reduced. But let me tell you that there are many good laws which say that do things quickly. They even lay down that it must be done within such and such period. But our judicial system is good. People are happy that we have independent judiciary. There are many countries in the world where the judiciary is not independent. The ruling authorities will order the judiciary what judgment to deliver, etc. We don't have that, and that is a very good thing. But there's a lot of delay. And today, Supreme Court, High Courts, they interfere in many cases, sometimes rightly, sometimes perhaps not their job, it's the job of somebody else, but they believe that those whose job it is are not doing a good job, so let us interfere. But how many cases are pending, and when are we going to settle these cases? It's only unless A judge thinks that there is some importance of a matter and therefore gives out of turn hearing, the cases are not being heard. And the number of cases pending all over our country, not only in the courts, but in the tribunals, etc. Now, therefore, this attempt is sought to be made that this tribunal and the functioning will be done under the new act expeditiously. But I have my own doubt because they will try to do expeditiously and a clever person who doesn't want to pay will go to the courts and get the stay. There'll be validity of the bankruptcy code 2016. There'll be interpretation of this and on factual data. So I think it is very, very important that the judiciary also, if they find that the justice is done, the stage must come where they say, all right, this is not my business. There is a code. There's an authority under the court, and if the authority has taken a decision, then we should not interfere, because it's true that, well, you can't, the judiciary cannot sort out all the injustices done. In the process, the injustice is added on by the lot of time wasted. So I think I have written down something about what I was supposed to speak, since I was not supposed to speak. I just... But I'll pass on within a day or two, so that Rasi, if she's going to make some of the speeches which are made, then I'll be able to pass it on. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Parikh. Any of the young generation lawyers or the students who have any questions in their mind? Because, of course, I'm not asking any senior persons, because I know that they are all well conversant, and throughout the discussion which took place throughout the day, we all feel enlightened. But I would specifically like to have questions from the young generations.
So, hello, my name is Abhishek Bhatt, and I would like to put a question towards the panel. Basically, the conflict between RERA and the IBC, so for on behalf of the allottees or the home buyers, for example, in RERA, the home buyers can form an association of persons and then complete the construction of the unconstructed building as such. And in the IBC, there can be a committee of creditors which can be formed, and then they can oversee the plans. So which will be given primacy, which will be considered like... There's a lot of confusion in this, because after the amendment in 2018 regarding the allottees being financial creditors, so what should the allottees do? So for example, after the judgment of the
Parliament,
the Honorable
Wisdom has passed RERA as well as IBC. The Honorable Supreme Court in the JP case has given a direction to the he has observed that an amendment, it is better to bring an amendment. On that count, an amendment was brought on in the year 6-6-2018, saying that the allottees have to be treated as a financial creditors. If you want to go to RERA with a complaint, you can do that. Otherwise, you can come before the NCLT. Almost in both the acts, the remedy is almost the same. Here also the COC will take care of all those things. RP will continue the building activities, construction activities, and then they will try to give you a solution. So it is your preference only. If you want to go to RERA, you can go. Otherwise, if you prefer IBC, you can come under the IBC.
Supplementing little more, in the JP case, which is a very landmark case regarding home buyers, where they were given the status of a financial creditor from that of an operational creditor. It was further clarified in the judgment, if you go through that judgment of the Supreme Court, that all other alternative forums are available to you. You can go to the consumer court. Consumer forum is available. RERA is available. All other alternative mechanisms are available. And therefore, your invoking the insolvency court will not oust your right to go to any other alternative.
There is no doubt that IBC is an excellent piece of legislation to de-stress the company which are under stress. I have a submission and question here regarding the resolution, which is, I think, the central objective of this code. In resolution plan, there is a value called resolution plan value, which is more or less, I think, is comparable these days, whatever resolution plan has come, to the liquidation value. There is a concept of enterprise value, but that is not there. There is no provision in the code itself or regulations about the resolution comparing with the enterprise value. But when we take the concept of going concern, I think it should match to the either to the market value, which is a business value of that particular entity, or enterprise value. What we are comparing is that resolution plan value is being compared with the liquidation value. My objective is a fallout. Liquidation is a fallout. But my objective is resolution. So in the resolution, whether there should be a provision of enterprise value so that we can really attain the objective of maximization of the value. As of now, there is no concept of enterprise value in the IBC.
See, the resolution ultimately first aims at restructuring, and the liquidation is only to be taken as a last resort. So whatever is possible, that's the whole what we were discussing now with the member of the NCLT, what we were feeling was, instead of focusing, the code itself provides an insight into all these objectives, but it is necessarily a resolution mechanism which is to be adopted, resulting into liquidation at a later stage when the resolution is not possible. So somehow the value, they may not be, it will be up to the body of creditors to see to it how it is adjusted, and it's not something which is hard and fast. So the discretion is left as to what value that will have to be determined. And I think I'll just hand over to the member of the NCLT who would be able to explain it to him in a practical tone.
Thank you, madam. See, like during my presentation, I would also said about the fair value. I think the fair value is nothing but your enterprise value. But though the act, the code provides that, the regulation provides that, it's the fair value and the liquidation value. In general, like the people that take only about the liquidation value and plus about, so anything plus the liquidation value, they're taking it as a resolution value. So this concept, like again, the bankers or the COC, they should take a conscious call. What should be the value should be accepted. If, for example, if anything is between the liquidation value and the fair value, whether any amount has been given in between can be considered or not, it's for the COC to take a call on that.
Sir, actually, I was just hinting on the enterprise
value. Wait, just
value.
A minute. See, sir. you can say liquidation value, fair value, enterprise value, whatever the nomenclature you can say. But the market should take it. That is all. That is the most important thing. See, if the pen, this is a product, this may cost 100 rupees. Your fair value may say 50 rupees. But only when the takers are there, see, only when the competition is there, when the business is good, some takers will come. Right. See, if you go on only on the enterprise value, then if you insist for enterprise value, then it has to go to liquidation only. See, if the competition is there, if many bidders are there, you will get the price. So these are all in corporate insolvency, if there's regulations, they are saying this fair value, liquidation value and all those things. See, this is to have a figure. But whether we can achieve that figure or not is a practical thing. You have right. to take a pragmatic view.
My question is more on the practical aspect of everyday NCLT. Do the members feel that a limited time should be allotted to make submissions, and other submissions can be canvassed through written submissions because of the pendency of cases before NCLT, especially when the individuals and proprietor firms will be under the purview of IBC code?
We are hearing the cases. After hearing only, we are asking you to submit the written submissions. That's what we are following it.
My question was that a limited time should be allotted because of the pendency of cases before NCLT, the everyday board.
Council, basically, like even though like we say there's a time frame, most of the people, they don't obey that, okay? So we want to give the fair hearing, okay? So if you're giving only 5 minutes or the 10 minutes, even though like if we have 70 cases listed, so you people will feel aggrieved. So it's clearly like we give it a fair hearing. The natural justice, we are following that, okay? Sometimes the time may not be, so we will postpone the matters and we sit late up to 6-7 also, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I don't suppose you have a query about the High Court who don't allow you to argue your matters when the court says now enough. This brings us to the end of the session. Indeed, it was an interesting discussion by the panel members. And as I began with the thought that this is a code which is a novice and it's still in a developing and an evolving stage, we have seen its birth, but it is still in the teething phase. And therefore, now what the problems are being faced after 3 years of this code being coming into existence, this we have deliberated upon to some extent. There are going to be transitional phases because the all other legislations which did away and culminated into the code. So there are a lot of pending cases with the NCLT, and probably that is the reason and answer to your this thing that they are flocked up with matters, and the duration, the most important aspect of the code is the timeline. I myself have a query as to whether, I don't know, because the timeline we have seen, Justice Ramanna in the morning have also said that if you get a lucrative offer after a deadline is over, what to do? Is it so sacrosanct, the timeline is so sacrosanct, then you'll have to apply the provisions, what are the mandatory and directory provisions when it can be construed. Of course, no doubt the object is to see to it that the resolution takes place in a limited time, but whether it should be an ultimate word that not a day here or not a day here, a day there, probably this issue would also have to be deliberated some or the other time. So I must say that the glass is now half full. It is for all of us, those stakeholders who are present here today, to see to it that we make the glass full, and contribution from each one of you who have attended the conference is most welcome, and that would make the glass full. I'm indeed grateful to the organizers for giving me an opportunity to be here. And as I entered, when our Honorable the Chief Justice entered, he asked us, where is your booklet? You have not anything material. So your glass is full, your cup is, you have come with an empty cup. I said, yes, it's always better to come with an empty cup so that I go home with a full cup. Thank you very much. With this, we bring an end to the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor, for an encouraging closing remark. And now, to present a memento to Honorable Justice J. Bharati Dangre, I request Kumar Shashank, Advocate, Supreme Court of India, to please join us on the dais.
Ladies and gentlemen, this was our second technical panel, very well conducted by the Honorable Justice.